This morning, in the middle of my morning routine, making coffee and feeding my dogs, Amazon had just made CodeWhisperer available to the general public. I dropped everything I was doing, ran to the computer, got set up with it as fast as I could and started playing around with it because I was really excited. Now, CodeWhisperer is a code generation tool much like GitHub Copilot. If you use code generation tools, you know they can really improve your workflow. In this video, I want to show you how to get set up with it so that you can start playing with it, seeing how well it helps your workflow, writing code, fixing bugs, your general productivity. Let's check it out. In order to get started with CodeWhisperer, what you need to do is come over to this page, aws.amazon.com/CodeWhisperer. What we will need to do beyond that is we will install the AWS Toolkit. We're gonna be doing this in VS Code. We're gonna install the AWS Toolkit in VS Code. We are going to open the developer tools and connect to CodeWhisperer. And at that point in time, we should be up and running with CodeWhisperer. Now, there's gonna be a couple things that you need. If you decide to use the AWS Toolkit for more than just CodeWhisperer, you'll need to connect that to your AWS account. But you don't need that for CodeWhisperer. But for CodeWhisperer, you do need an AWS Builder ID if you don't already have one. I didn't have one, and this is the first time I'd even heard of AWS Builder ID, but just wanna let you know that ahead of time. So let's go ahead and check out this website, click around, check out the pricing and that kind of stuff because there's a lot of good information here. And the setup is a little bit confusing. So we are on CodeWhisperer and I wanted to compare one particular point to GitHub Copilot. So let's go ahead and check it out. So CodeWhisperer promises to be your AI coding companion and help you build applications faster and more securely. One of the best parts about it is free for individual use. But if you're using it as part of a company, you have to, that company has to integrate it with AWS IAM Identity Center, otherwise known as AWS SSO. They made a branding change there. And if you're using it as part of a company, it's $19 per user per month. Comparing that to CodePilot, CodePilot out of the box is $10 for individuals per month. It's $19 per user per month for business. So right off the bat, Amazon CodeWhisperer is free for individuals. So that is a nice boon. I'm sure they're gonna pick up a lot of users based on that simple fact alone. But similarly to GitHub Copilot, it can generate code for you. It can help you make sure that that code is done reasonably securely. And it's interesting because like some of the issues that I've seen with GitHub Copilot and particularly OpenAI's ChatGPT is like whenever you're asking those tools to generate particularly Terraform, sometimes there are security issues in there, particularly predominantly open ports is the main thing I'm thinking of, that you have to be aware of. And so anytime you have code being generated by an AI tool or being suggested to you by an AI tool, always say with a grain of salt, including CodeWhisperer or GitHub Copilot or ChatGPT or whatever, are the tools in the future. But one of the big things about CodeWhisperer is they're really kind of leaning in on that fact. And they're saying, you know, you can be sure that the code you are generating is okay. According to like MIT license, it is going to be, they're gonna be pointing out security issues and they integrate with two predominant developer tools. One of them being VS Code and the other one being the IntelliJ or the JetBrains IDEs. So we're talking about like IntelliJ, PyCharm, so forth and so on. And it works with, I think, 10 different or 15 different programming languages right out the gate. Main ones that I'm gonna be using it for are Python and TypeScript. And we're gonna see if it can work with Terraform, but I believe it can also work with like shell scripts. So I'm really excited about that. Because whenever you start getting into stuff like awk and sed, and JQ on the command line, some of that stuff can get really hairy. So anything that can help generate those types of commands and parameters for those particular commands is gonna be very, very helpful. So this is the website, once again, aws.amazon.com/CodeWhisperer. It's not terribly complicated to get set up. If you click around and you get in here, They tell you how to set up, but I'm gonna walk you through it right now, and we're gonna be doing this for VS Code, as I mentioned earlier. So we're gonna leave the website behind, and we're gonna jump right over to VS Code and start getting set up with CodeWhisperer. So let's go ahead and shut this. And the first thing that we're gonna need to do is we're gonna need to come into the extension section of VS Code. And I'm doing this on Mac. It might be a little bit different if you are on Windows, but the first thing we're gonna do is we're gonna search for AWS Toolkit. We'll pull it up. We're gonna go ahead and install it. Make sure you're getting the one from Amazon Web Services. It has a little check mark. So we'll go ahead and click install. And now in the left-hand column here, we get an Explorer section and we also get a developer tools section. This might be collapsed down here, so make sure you expand it and you can see CodeWhisperer. Next, what you're going to do is you're going to select a connection. Now, I already have a connection set up, but I'm gonna go ahead and add a new connection. And if you are working with CodeWhisperer, I'm actually gonna do this a little bit differently. If you are working with CodeWhisperer and you click start here, it will tell you this, but you need to use either an AWS Builder ID if you're just doing this for your personal development. If you're doing it as part of a company, you will need to connect with AWS IAM Identity Center, otherwise known as AWS SSO. IAM credentials are not supported by CodeWhisperer, and it tells you so at this point in time. This may change in the future, but right now you've got to use AWS Builder ID, which I had never even heard of before I set this up, or AWS IAM Identity Center. So we're going to go ahead and use AWS Builder ID, and it's going to give you a code. We're going to copy code, and we'll open this. We're going to paste this in here. And we'll go ahead and allow this. I guess I've already typed in my credentials, so we should be good to go. Yeah, so you can see that CodeWhisperer is working because it says pause auto suggestions, run security scan, so forth and so on. So we're gonna go ahead and start playing around with it. You don't have to have any IAM credentials, like you don't have to have the Explorer connected to use CodeWhisperer, but you do need that AWS Builder ID at the very least. And if you need to set up an AWS Builder ID, it's like every other website, I feel like, on the planet, and you can just set up a username, password kind of thing and get running. So the first thing that we're gonna do is we're gonna start playing around with some of the code generation for Python in particular. So what I'm gonna do is I'm going to copy a prompt in, and that prompt is we're gonna write a Python function to return the nth prime number in Python. Make sure we wanna sanitize all inputs. We want to always return an integer and an invalid input. Let's say somebody tries passing in a string because this is Python. And there's not strong or strict typing. Anytime somebody dumps in an invalid input, I wanna return a negative one. And so the other thing is we're gonna give it a couple of examples. Nth prime one, the first one, it will return back two. We'll add in one more example here. Nth prime number two is three. And it's already generating a code example there. So if we hit option C, it should start generating code for us. We'll go ahead and let it take a moment. And so right off the bat, we can tell that this hasn't like completely understood everything that I said in the comment prompt to generate this code. And I had to mess around with this a fair bit earlier to get this to work right. But for the most part, this code is okay. But I said invalid inputs return a negative one. And so the way it took that was if n is less than one, return negative one. So we're gonna go ahead and use the next. So this is better. If type n does not equal integer, return negative one. Else if n is less than one, return a negative one. And then otherwise, it looks like this is actually generating a list of prime numbers. And it's going to, okay, I see what it's doing. So it's generating a list of prime numbers and then saying the way it's doing the indexing is taking the index minus one in that list, that should work. And I've seen this, I should have just left that. I should have actually accepted that code. And it's not gonna give it to me anymore.
Let's see.
Okay, we'll go ahead and hit tab to accept this. Something I've seen it do from time to time is rather than having a function here, what it will do is it will have a, rather than having all this code explicitly spelled out, for this exact example, I had it actually reference an isPrime function before it returned that value. But it didn't generate that isPrime function. It didn't actually generate isPrime function for reference. It didn't do this, but it did reference it in this code up here. And so it's kind of interesting. Imagine this code isn't here, and all of a sudden you've got if is prime type thing, and it's passing in a number here to this function. And so that was kind of interesting to me. That was like a gap. But I actually like that this code example, just everything's included in one function call. So let's go ahead and jump over to another code example. And there's nothing that I see about this that like really stands out that this is really an issue. This is not necessarily how I would write this function, but write this code, but it does get the job done. So we'll use another example here, which I think is a little bit more relevant to people like myself who are working with like the AWS API a whole lot. With Python code in particular, and that is we're going to use Botto 3, that package, to work with the AWS API. Now, if you decide to read this, that's absolutely fine, but the gist is write a Python function that uploads a text file to an S3 bucket using the Botto 3 library. And I provide some other information here around what I want to be able to handle. I want it to have named parameters, and I want to do sanitation of inputs. Like, that's really important. That's where a lot of bugs come from, is if you don't sanitize those inputs. And whenever I was playing with this earlier, the code that it actually generated for this was not right at all. And I'm going to show you why. And if you go to the website, it actually references some of these points, but I want to show you what I found as well. So we're going to go ahead and hit option C and wait for it to generate. Okay, so that it didn't even pick up that I was asking for it to do that. So we'll go ahead and do it this way. So it has generated a stub for a method. That's cool. But we're gonna ask for it to actually generate this. So it's not even generating the code that I need. So we're gonna see if it generates anything better. This returns nothing. It does return a dictionary, but the dictionary doesn't have the right information. None of this actually works. And so what I actually found I had to do, and the CodeWhisperer website does mention this, is I have to actually act like I've imported Botto for it to pick up on this and want to generate code for me. So we'll give this another shot. And it's just not picking up on it. It's not picking up on the fact that Botto exists there. And it's interesting because like earlier this was working. It was once I imported Botto 3, this code that was generated did sort of work. Okay, here we go. Now we're getting somewhere. So let's go ahead and accept this code. So if you notice, it did not do any sort of sanitization of the incoming data, even though I explicitly said sanitize all inputs. So you could do type checking. You could do you could make sure that like the strings are not empty. You can do a whole bunch of things around this stuff. You can make sure the file exists, so forth and so on. But it did not actually do that, and so that's a little frustrating. And this. One of the things I think that's important with a lot of this stuff is it doesn't tell you, like with this function call, you should actually say like, this is the file name. I forget exactly what it is. And this over here is the object name. And maybe I'm getting these parameters wrong. And this is like the bucket name. maybe this this is not the exact named parameters for this, but this is the code that was originally generated without me putting these names in here is a little confusing. Because if you didn't know what this function call was, you might be like, why is it putting the file name in here twice? And so forth and so on. And the other thing is it does do what I asked around returning a dict of the status, either success or failure, and tell me why it failed. But I feel like I had to do a whole lot more massaging of this. And whenever I've worked with GitHub Copilot in the past, or even ChatGPT to generate code along these lines, I felt like both of those out of the gate worked better than this. Like I felt like I had to do less explanation in order to get those two AI models to generate code. Whereas this one I had to be like very explicit, and the more explicit I was, the better it got. But I had to do a bunch of massaging. Still, the fact that it's free is great. And I think something in this case is better than nothing, especially whenever you're trying to learn how to write code in like new languages and things like that. So let's switch gears and let's move over to shell scripting. And so the reason why I want to do shell scripting is I really want to try something here. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to provide this comment: print out a list of files in the current directory and all subdirectories recursively that end with .tf or .py. Now, I have not written code for this, and so we're both seeing this for the first time. So I believe that this would work for the current directory. I'm not sure that this would work for the subdirectories. I could be wrong, but just wanted to give you an idea that like it might generate something like this. We could potentially give that a shot. I will go ahead and open up a terminal and navigate to that. And let's actually just test this out. You know what I mean? Let's give this a shot. And so what I want to also do is I want to mention, I have a subdirectory inside this Code Whisperer folder. And so if we just do a quick ls, you can see this subdir, ls, subdir. We've got other files in here. And then if we do ls al subdir, we have another subdir that has another tf file. So let's go ahead and try this out and see what happens. Okay, so it pulled up all the files. So this code just right out of the box does work, which is actually pretty nice. Like I don't know all of the shell commands and all the shell programs that are built in. But the fact that there's something like this where I can take something that like might not be the most intuitive right out of the box and just have it dump out some shell code is actually pretty nice. And then I'm gonna test it on this. I don't expect it to actually even work at all for this because I don't remember if Code Whisperer supports Terraform right out of the box. I would imagine not, because Amazon and AWS really push CloudFormation and CDK rather than Terraform. So we're just gonna do this and see what happens. Okay, I don't know if you caught that in the bottom right-hand side, but it says Terraform is not currently supported by Code Whisperer. So Terraform just won't work. I hope you enjoyed that little exploration of Code Whisperer. Once again, if you are trying to get started with Code Whisperer on your own, go to aws.amazon.com/codewhisperer. It's pretty easy to set up. The fact that it's free is very nice once again. And I look forward to playing around with this a whole lot more and seeing what Amazon does or AWS does over time to make this a better tool for programmers and developers. Thanks for watching.